Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Reading from the Srimad Bhagavatam, 6th canto, 16th chapter, text number 6. Chapter entitled King Chitraketu Meets the Lord. Yata Vastuni Panyani Emadini Tatas Tata Parayatanti Nareshu Evan Jiva Yonisu Kartrisu Yata Vastuni Panyani Emadini Tatas Tataha Paryatanti Nareshvevam Jiva Yonishu Kartrishu Yata Vastuni Panyani Emadini Tatas Tataha Paryatanti Nareshvehang Jiva Yoni Shukatrishu Yata. Just as Vashtuni commodities, Panyani meant for trading, Hema Adini, such as gold, Tatak Tatak. From here to there, paryatanti, move about, nareshu, among men, evam, in this way, jiva, the living entity, yonisu, in different species of life, kartrishu, in different material fathers. Just as gold and other commodities are continually transferred from one place to another in due course of purchase and sale, so the living entity, as a result of his fruitive activities, wanders throughout the entire universe, being injected into various bodies in different species of life by one kind of father after another. Purport by His Divine Grace Srila Prabhupada. It has already been explained that Chitraketu's son was his enemy in a past life, and had now appeared as his son just to give him more severe pain. Indeed, the untimely death of his son caused severe lamentation for the father. One may put forward the argument, if the king's son was his enemy, how could the king have so much affection for him? In answer, the example is given that when someone's wealth falls into the hand of his enemy, the money becomes the enemy's friend. Then the enemy can use it for his own purposes. Indeed, he can even use it to harm its previous owner. Therefore, the money belongs neither to the one party nor to the other. The money is always money, but in different situations, it can be used as an enemy or a friend. As explained in Bhagavad Gita, it is not by any father or mother that the living entity is given his birth. The living entity is a completely separate identity from the so-called father and mother. By the laws of nature, the living entity is forced to enter the semen of a father and be injected into the womb of the mother. He is not in control of selecting what kind of father he will accept. Prakrite kriyamanani. The laws of nature force him to go to different fathers and mothers, just like a consumer commodity that is purchased and sold. Therefore, the so-called relationship of father and son is an arrangement of prakriti or nature. It has no meaning, and therefore it is called illusion. The same living entity sometimes takes shelter of an animal father and mother, and sometimes a human father and mother. Sometimes he accepts a father and mother among the birds, and sometimes he accepts a demigod father and mother. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu therefore says, Brahmanda Brahmate Kona Bhagyavan Jeev Guru Krishna Prasade Pai Bhakti Latta Bij. Harassed life after life by the laws of nature, the living entity wanders throughout the entire universe in different planets and different species of life. Somehow or other, if he is fortunate enough, he comes in touch with a devotee who reforms his entire life. Then the living entity goes back home, back to Godhead. Therefore it is said, Janame Janame Sabe Pita Matapai Krishna Guru Nahi Mile Bhaja Hari Ai. In the transmigration of the soul through different bodies, everyone in every form of life, be it human, animal, tree, or demigod, gets a father and mother. This is not very difficult. The difficulty is to obtain a bona fide spiritual master and Krishna. Therefore, the duty of a human being is to capture the opportunity to come in touch with Krishna's representative, the bona fide spiritual master. Under the guidance of the spiritual master, the spiritual father, one can return home back to Godhead. Om Agyana Timuranda Syagana Jana Shlakaya Chaksurimla Tamina Tasma Shri Gurave Namaha Ukam Karoti Vachalam Pangum Langhayate Gurim Yakripatamam Bande Shri Gurum Dinatanam. Translation again. Just as gold and other commodities are continually transferred from one place to another in due course of purchase and sale, so the living entity, as a result of his fruitive activities, wanders throughout the entire universe, being injected into various bodies in different species of life by one kind of father after another. Very interesting analogy, how the body is compared to a commodity. After all, the body is just some material elements bundled together in the form of some human or some cow. We don't even consider this situation very carefully. On our day-to-day basis, we're not thinking, walking around, that aham brahmasmi. In the beginning, there was more emphasis that I am spirit soul. But we see that there's been some transformation as we evolve in our consciousness. That in certain ashrams, there is more impetus to remain steady. One has to be a faithful servant of the spiritual master. So Prabhupada gave very much emphasis on this initial training. And he would joke, and he would have very casual conversations sometimes with his sannyas disciples, because they have taken that strict vow. But then he would also chide them that sannyas is not necessary. In the routine matters, he said. Routine. What does routine matter mean in this so-called material society? One has to extricate himself. He says, but for one who is a preacher, there is no need. So Srila Prabhupada's definition of advancement was not by the color of one's cloth, but by one's preaching. He said, this will determine. He said, in the beginning, we worship the deity. He says, but this is this beginning level. This is the beginning level. If one does not develop a taste for preaching, Srila Prabhupada said, then he is not making spiritual advancement. So this must be there. That desire to bring this knowledge outside. Everyone has experience. But somehow or other, we get entangled at times in Grihastha ashram, this ashram, that ashram. And then we think, oh, I have some other duty. But our only duty ever is to preach. Prabhupada told us in the early days that one should not become a grihastha unless he can do more service. So this is some imposition, because the grihastha is thinking, oh, I'm working so hard to maintain my family, how can I do more service? And many people take it as a license, that now I don't have to do any service, I just have to take care of my family. But no, this was not how we saw things when Srila Prabhupada was present. We have so many comfortable communities. After living in India for many years, I returned to America, and we, nice temple in Alachua, new Ramanreti. The transition from Ramanreti to new Ramanreti was some culture shock, you can say. Because everything is a little laid back in those days. But there was only a handful of devotees. And it was a fairly large property, 127 acres. So we thought how to increase the spiritual nature of the community. So I invited back to Godhead magazine. I said, I have land. I will give it to you rent-free. I will provide everything you require. You please relocate here. I didn't know if they would accept, but by Krishna's arrangement, they accepted. And then very nice devotees, Yamaraj, Jayadwaita Maharaj, so many devotees, Nagaraj, they came. And so kirtan became nice, and pravachan lectures became nice. And then we thought, how next to increase? Then we invited Bhaktivedanta Institute. I know Sadhaputta for many years. I said, Prabhu, very nice community we're building here. Nice place for the children. We're going to build a school. You'll have all facility. I gave the same thing, no rent ever. You just come. And he came. So just by asking, somehow or other Krishna made this arrangement. And classes, everyone became so enthusiastic. People started coming to join the temple, to move into the community, and then we built a school. So the reason I'm saying all this is that the community has to have a solid basis, and that there has to be the spiritual component that everyone subscribes to. It's like everyone is busy subscribing to something. You see everyone on their phones all the time, subscribing to this, subscribing to that, following this, Twitter feed, this feed, that feed. But our focus should be Krishna Balaram, Radhe Shyam, Sri Sri Gaur Nitai, Srila Prabhupada. That should be the focus. We should subscribe to them. And how our day, our activities, everything revolves around them only. And then we'll be peaceful. Then we can have everything. What is that verse? Dharma, sunustata pungsam, vishvaksena katasya, no padaya, radiratim, shama eva hi kevalam. It doesn't matter what else you do. Everything is shama eva hi kevalam. It's useless, waste of time, if Krishna is not properly in your focus, that I am his servant in every circumstance, not servant of my family. Not that we neglect family, no. Prabhupada said one should be externally henpecked. Everyone knows that term, henpecked? Says, but internally, he's only thinking, how can I increase my service? But externally, everything is yes, dear. This is the common term we use, yes, dear, to the wife. Yes, my dear wife, whatever you say. But we have to also do that service. By the grace of my good wife, I'm here doing service for Care for Cows, for Srila Prabhupada, for the GBC. So that is the support that we pray for, that our wives are giving us, to allow us to do this service peacefully without any distraction. And everything will come. The family will be blessed. But if one is thinking, no, I will just give my wife saris, gold bangles, and all this nice, nice house, what is the use of these things? These material things cannot make one happy. This is shown since time immemorial. Nobody can be happy with material things. Maharaj Chitraketu, he's the ruler of some unlimited kingdom. Nobody knows. You cannot fathom. It boggles our mind to think how many lakhs or crores of cows they had, you know, what their treasury was filled with, how much gold and riches, how many sacrifices. He had 100 wives, how many palaces, how many rooms in those palaces. Who can imagine? But yet he was not happy, and he wanted a son. But this son brought only misery. Of course, this analogy Prabhupada said, harsha shok, happiness and distress. Everything is there. And he clearly says he could have just thought of this person as an enemy. His enemy has come to give me trouble, now he is gone, good riddance. But by illusion only, we place some emphasis. Oh, this is my son, this is my daughter. And one, the hard knot in the heart becomes tighter and tighter until nothing can undo it. Chindanti Kovida. This is the thing. This is why we have to carefully study the Srimad Bhagavatam. Because that knowledge can cut. It is described just like a sword. There is a famous story in Greek philosophy called the Gordian knot. It was a very special knot. Sometimes they see pictures. Impossible to untie. Impossible. So many people had attempted and no one could succeed. So one king, Alexander, he was challenged, most likely by Brahmanas, because he was invading. He was coming over into India. And they said, first you answer this challenge, you untie this knot. So he's a Kshatriya. What did he do? He took out his sword and he cut the knot. He's done. That was the answer. That's how you untie the Gordian knot. You cut it, because it cannot be untied. So this knot in the heart, it cannot be untied. You cannot untangle it, disentangle it. You can try for millions of years. You can only cut it with the sword of knowledge. But that cannot be done if you're daily thinking everything else but Krishna. How to do this for my family, how to do this for this business, how to do this. No, it cannot be done. One has to only be thinking, how can I please Srila Prabhupada? How can I push on this movement? What can I do to represent him? How can I dress? How can I look? Who can I meet? Everything has to be done for him, for the spiritual master in Krishna. That is our consciousness. That if I have the opportunity to meet someone today, I will impress him about the superiority of Krishna consciousness. Not artificially, not by my endeavor is this philosophy superior, but by the words of the Shastra, by simple presentation, without concoction. Then we see great, anyone who is a little submissive, he will appreciate, and he will make benefit. His journey on the path will start. And that is all that is required. Our 2-minute talk, Prabhupada said, what can it do? As he was discussing with the book distributors. You know, sometimes you get distracted. You think, oh, I'm such a great preacher. I will convince this person. And 20 minutes is wasted and 20 people have gone by who could have had a book. Prabhupada said, what can your 2 minutes talking do? He said, get them to take a book. Because then his life is perfect. There's Prabhupada's words, The words of Sri Krishna, that's what will change a person's heart. We are only the instruments. So they, I like this part about considering that who is giving you some suffering? We know there are so many enemies. So many enemies. Who knows what was our relationship last life? I was the father, they were the father, I was the son, they were the son, who knows? Everything has changed like this from one birth to another. But we should know one thing, that in this life, we can finish this business of birth and death and then not have to ever have consider this again. We're reviewing this philosophy, reviewing, because we've done this before. Abrahma Bhuvana Loka, this is from the highest to the lowest, and Brahmanda Brahmate Kona Bhagivanji. We've done this so many times. How many more times do we want to do this? Prabhupada said, finish it this life only. But we can make up so many things. There are so many distractions. If you go on the internet, so many people with opposing ideas. This is kind, that is kind, not is kind. What to do? You have to read Srila Prabhupada's books. Then all these things become like distant barking of dogs. It is not important. It is just a distraction. Maya is put there to trap you. Nobody needs controversy. If one is enthusiastic for controversy and conspiracy, that is the whole material world. The whole material world is a conspiracy by Maya to keep you trapped here. So now that you know that, why would you re-engage again in this mundane world of transient relationships? But somehow or other, we have a little attachment. So we keep our alliances. We satisfy certain people. I have clients as a business. So we talk with them. At the same time, we have to try to balance everything. But it's the same as dealing with anything. You have to speak to them in such a way that you do not compromise yourself in your relationship with the spiritual master and Krishna. And just by thinking how to do that, it will keep you safe. Just by thinking how to do that. Because everything requires that balance. So what will be the result of Maharaj Chitraketu? The spirit soul has come and given him very good instructions. Which father and mother are you? It would have been very interesting if he would have said, yes, I am your enemy. Last life I took your whole kingdom and stole all your wives and treasury. That would have really given him a shock. But instead the basic understanding was there. And now he is apparently free from illusion. And we'll see further on how this knowledge saves him. So just hearing submissively from the spiritual master. And of course, you see here he's coming in due to his suffering. As many as I have, certainly. I didn't come due to knowledge. I came, I wanted to know the truth. But I was not ready to accept the truth until I was completely devastated materially. Because one is holding out some hope. That's why they have that term, hope against hope. What does that mean, hope against hope? Someone is hopeless, but still he's thinking, yes. It's like a gambler. He's exhausted his money, and we saw that with the Pandavas, the same thing. Exhausted all their money. Then what do? Then they wager their brothers, their wives. Such a desperate addiction. So the living entity is desperately He's wagering, what are the wages? This life, which has been received after so much wandering and having come in contact with the pure devotee, with Srila Prabhupada, again, if one wants to engage in activities which will drive him away into some another hopeless condition. Prabhupada said, Krishna is very merciful. He can give you anything you want. You want big buildings? He said this in Mayapur 1976. He can give you big buildings. But you will have to take another birth. And there will be a gap of millions of years. Sometimes you see, even devotees are thinking, oh yes, I'll just engage in some whatever business this, and I'll take birth again as a devotee. Prabhupada said, no. No. He said there will be a gap of millions of years. That is the trade. You want some material thing? Yes, you can have it. Take. And then take another birth. And another birth, and another birth. Millions of years to the human form of life. So I encourage everyone that if you get the chance, please listen to Srila Prabhupada's lectures. They are pure nectar. Everyone, of course, is reading Prabhupada's books. But these lectures are like every day. You know, there's, I say it frequently, but it bears repeating. There is one famous record label. It is called HMV. Everyone knows what that means? HMV? It means His Master's Voice. And they used to have a dog listening to this thing which used to be on the old phonograph. It's like a big funnel. And so the dog is recognizing that this is my master's voice. They were using it to say that such an accurate reproduction that even a dog could recognize his master's voice. So every day, by listening to our master's voice, we remember who we are. We are the dog of the spiritual master. That is our position. If one is thinking anything else, he's thinking, oh yes, I'm a big, big man. I no longer need this society. I have graduated. I am now zamindar. I am businessman. I am property holder. I have achieved my goal in life. So don't think that this can't happen. It happens all the time. One comes to spiritual life, but then he becomes distracted. And mostly it begins with the grihastha ashram, but it doesn't necessarily. We've seen many brahmacharis make those same mistakes. Think that the property of the spiritual master is actually mine, or I deserve some of it. I've worked so hard. So one should not be such a fool to act in this capacity. For him, the darkest regions of hell are waiting. There's no doubt. So translation again. Just as gold and other commodities are continually transferred from one place to another in due course of purchase and sale, so the living entity, as a result of his fruitive activities, wanders throughout the entire universe, being injected into various bodies in different species of life by one kind of father after another. So are there any questions, comments, or critiques? We have a little time. And the microphone is right here. Jai Prabhupada. To speak louder.
I have it in the house. I want to see how that goes. Transmigration and reincarnation. How does Prabhupada use these two things?
Transmigration and reincarnation. Very nice question. And we know transmigration of the soul is described in Bhagavad Gita. Dehino sminyata dehe komaram yovanam jara. So that means the soul changes from body to body. Reincarnation is commonly misunderstood by those who are not fully versed in the science of self-realization, to think that I again become a human being. You know, that's that we have published that book, Coming Back, where in many instances someone is remembering a previous human birth. We very rarely see someone coming back and remembering a dog's birth. They don't start barking. Of course, maybe they do. Mental institutions are filled with people barking like dogs. So maybe we just haven't recognized that they have reincarnated from their past life as a dog. But typically, it's meant to be the same term. But if we use them to a person with less knowledge, he will think it means to take birth again as a human being, and that is not a fact. Transmigration means in every species of life. And then in the human form of life, from boyhood to youth to old age, and then into another body, but Prabhupada said a gap of millions of years. It is not that I die and... But if one is a devotee and he is not by some fault of his own, you can say. Everything ultimately is our responsibility. But if it was due to some weakness of heart, not by some aparad, not by some offense, and we saw like even Ajamil, he was rectified. He was allowed to, even in his own body, you can say, he came back. Because the Yamadutas took him out of his body. But then the Vishnudutas allowed him to go back into the same body. He didn't have to. He died. There's no doubt. But then he came back and he was allowed to perfect his life. So that, for a devotee, that is possible. That he can take birth again. You know, Suchinam, Srimatam, Gehe, in a pious family. But not if he's doing some nonsense. Baba gave so many examples about sannyasis in Vrindavan taking birth as monkeys. So even if one comes to that level where he has renounced everything, but somehow or other he has not renounced sense gratification and continues to act on the bodily platform while externally dressed as a renunciant, that is a much greater punishment than someone who is a simple sweeper in the street, but is honest, and whatever he has, he gives to Krishna. Does that answer your question, Prabhu? Uh-oh, your enemy has come. Pass the mic. From fruitive desires? One has to think that, what does it fruitive mean? I expect the results of my activities. So the opposite of that is nice karma, which is devotional service. Whatever one does, yat kuroshi yat asnasi yat jahosi didasi yat yat tapasyasi kaunteya. Whatever one does, he does for Krishna. The formula is there. Krishna has told us. So if I'm thinking, you know, even in mundane, Some boy is thinking, I'll please this girl, I'll bring some flowers. So Krishna says, Patram Pushpam Palam Doyam Yome Bhakti Prayachati. So give these flowers to Krishna. We just have to put Krishna in the center, keep him the focus of our attention. It is difficult. It is never easy. That which is valuable is not easy. If one wants to get a diamond, he has to make a great endeavor to collect the funds necessary. But if one wants something cheap, then he can get something very cheap very easily. So this process is simultaneously very easy for those who are simple and very difficult for those who are crooked, who are thinking, how many ways I can do this? Someone is, Prahlad Maharaj in seventh canto, which along the lines of commodity, Lord Nrisimhadeva is offering him benediction. Whatever you want. Whatever you want. Already he has inherited the kingdom of his father. But he says, whatever any other benediction. Lord Nrisimhadeva is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. He can give anything. So someone without that proper attitude of devotion, he'll think, oh, now's my chance. Let me get that, what can you get? What is greater than devotional service? But someone is thinking, yes, let me have a nice car. Let me have a nice house. So how foolish is that? And there are so many stories along that line. But what did Prahlad Maharaj say? He says, I am not Vanik. I am not Baniya. You're offering something in exchange, but this is not I have not entered into this relationship with you as some mercantile exchange. So he directly, in that sense, we know that term, Baniya. So he's saying, I'm not Baniya. I only want pure devotional service. No exchange, no commodity. That which cannot be had except by developing this attitude of love and devotion. It comes down to that. If one loves the spiritual master, he will not do anything to displease him, any more than he would do anything to displease his girlfriend, wife, father, mother. You cannot simultaneously say, yes, I love you, but then I go behind your back and I steal your property, I steal your assets. No, it is. Where is that love? Actually, they're saying, I love your money. And it's that there are such relationships. We see people marry, they're called gold diggers. I don't know what the equivalent term in India is. Gold digger. Someone who marries only for money. They say, let me marry this rich person. Doesn't matter, man or woman. Let me marry this rich person, I will get all their assets. And typically they marry some person who is very old, about to die. So they know I will get everything very quickly. I don't have to be subservient for a long time. So this type of calculation, this is that Baniya mentality, Banik. I will serve the spiritual master until I get some material benefit. And then I will reject. Maybe not reject openly, I will still maybe keep the uniform. There are even terms like this. Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur very meticulously examined the situation. And he gave this term, Dharma Dwaji. Dharma Dwaji. Everyone should know this term. What does Dharma Dwaji mean? Who waves the flag of Dharma? Seems like a good thing, right? Dharma Dwaji. But it is someone who is a pretender. This name means pretender. He waves the flag of Dharma, but he is adharmic. He is only using it as a means for advancing himself materially. And the other term is Kali Chela. This is a little more complex. Kali Chela is described, he's wearing tilak, he's wearing neck beads, but he's an agent of Kali. So what does that mean? That even in the society of devotees, there are people who are only looking out for themselves, not for the interest of the spiritual master or the spiritual master society or for the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Their only interest is me. But they will adopt this garb, and it is not unique. It is not that Kali Chela only exists in Sanskrit. In the material world, we run across this common in so many churches. Fraud is prevalent. Why? Because everybody is falsely trusting. It even has a name. There's a whole category. It is called affinity fraud. Affinity. What does affinity mean? I'm close to someone or something. We have some common attraction, mutual appreciation. But someone exploits that. And they say, oh, Prabhu, there's this wonderful scheme and you will get 2% per month. You just give your money to me and I will invest it for you. And because this person looks like a devotee, they go, oh, this person won't cheat me. And he says, oh, and such person has also invested and such person has also invested. In this way, I know many devotees who have lost lakhs and lakhs of rupees to other devotees. Because of this misplaced sense of trust. We only trust Prabhupada. There's a nice thing if you go into America, almost any store, very prominently behind the counter, it says, in God we trust, all others pay cash. Because that is the motto of America, in God we trust. It is on every piece of money that is coined by America. You take any dollar bill, any change, it says, in God we trust. But even the bani as in America, no, in God we trust, all others pay cash. Which means, yes, I trust you, but pay me cash. Trust but verify. If something is sounds too good to be true, usually it is. Do not become falsely trapped by agents of Maya trying to separate you from the cash that you should be giving to Krishna. So when I hear these devotees come to me and they complain, oh Prabhu, I lost 13 lakh, this person took, he was supposed to invest. I said, you should have given it to Krishna. You should have given it to Krishna. You had 13 lakh to invest with some cheater, you didn't give it to Krishna or give it to Prabhupada? What is this? So what happens? Krishna takes it away. Krishna takes it away. Any other questions, comments? Prabhu, can you pass the microphone?
Hare Krishna.
Hare Bol.
I found very interesting how you said that. People usually don't remember they were dog in previous life. So I was wondering how you saw it. Because you have these regression sessions. Even though I know for some cases, when you go in London, there's many regressions. There are some people who think that.
I mean, obviously, everything is linked. Prabhu is talking about regression. Some devotees have involved themselves in these types of endeavors. But Prabhupada said it's a very dangerous thing. If one remembers his past life, perhaps there is something that he is not meant to remember. Maybe that which you remember drives you crazy. So he specifically warned against this. I have this life. I can give it to the spiritual master and Krishna. Why do I have to worry about what happened previous life? By his mercy, I am here. By some million chance, I have come in contact with the pure devotee. I have won the lottery. If you win the lottery, do you just throw away the money? No. Otherwise, you'll be seen as very foolish. So anyone who takes this human form of life after having come in contact with the pure devotee, Srila Prabhupada, and then again he wastes it, he has to be the most foolish person. Just like a lottery winner who throws away his money. So we should not be foolish. We have this life. We know where I am. I'm sitting here in Krishna Balaram Mandir. I'm in the presence of the pure devotee. We have his Vani and his Vapu. We have everything here. There is nothing lacking. But still someone is thinking, no, maybe I have to do something, go someplace, listen something. No. I have to go listen to some Barshana Baba. I have to go to some Rasiya. That will not bring about this change of heart. This change of heart comes from Chaita Dharpanam Arjanam Bhava Mahadevani Nirvapanam. These are all linked. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu gave us this Shikshastik, 8 verses, 8. There are hundreds of thousands of verses. And people are fully absorbed in some activity, some saptaha, this, that, the other thing. But everything condensed into 8 verses. Nadanam najanam nasundarim kavita vajagadishakame mama janmini janmini ishwe bhavatad bhaktir ahoitaki tvayi, ahoitaki. So one has to think like this. It's difficult, yes. But I didn't come to this movement to get rich. We actually left everything behind. We don't care for any place specific. Wherever we can lie down, wherever we can do service, if we're fortunate, Krishna will give us just what we need. I remember one time, I was driving to Makrana on my Enfield, because in those days we didn't have, if you took train, there was only meter gauge. It took so long through Agra, through Jaipur, to Makrana. To go, Makrana is 550 kilometers one way, 475, depending on the train. But if you take a train, it takes more than 20 hours in those days. And that train was this burning cola, you know? So inside the train is so hot, you have to have the windows open. But if you have the windows open, you become black from the coal burning, and you're breathing it. So you cannot breathe. So it is like sitting in a hellish situation. Sometimes no one even wants to sit behind another car with the motor running for 1 minute. That diesel fume, he's thinking, oh, this is terrible. Try sitting in a train for 20 hours breathing coal, and just, you can't, it's in. So I thought at least the Enfield will get there clean. And quicker. It only takes to go there 7 hours by Enfield. So one time we were coming back and I had my assistant, Achyuta. He was riding on the back. It was his first time to Makrana. It was his first time on a motorcycle. First time to, he was doing a lot of firsts that day. And first time to have an accident. Some truck pushed us off the side of the road. They tried it, they're going so fast. Motorcycle doesn't go so fast. And this is a stone road. The roads to Makrana are paved with marble chunks. Completely cut your road, there's no road. Whatever marble rubble is left from the carving, they throw it onto the road. And for a truck, it doesn't matter. But for a motorcycle, it's a little tricky. And my back tire punctured. So the bike started to move. Achyuta couldn't stay straight, and so it went down at some point. And the fork was totally twisted. So people in Rajasthan are very sweet. One town we close by, we used to pass through all the time. The town is called Dudu. Such a name, Dudu. Anytime you go into Makrana, there was one nice Daba. When he would see us, we would come and we would bring calendar. In the old days, you gave everybody calendar. And he would always treat us to cow's milk. He had a cow, and he knew we're devotees. We're trying to be devotees. So he would always give us cow's milk whenever we would stop there. And a few minutes, we would converse in our little broken Hindi. And if we were hungry, he would cook some dry potato sabji. And he would wash the wok meticulously, because they use the wok for everything. But he would take cow dung, because he knew. This is Vedic culture. They're eating meat. All the Rajputs, they're eating meat. They're eating goat, not cow. And they're cooking, and he has one tin. He doesn't have another pot. But he wants to do something for us. So he takes that karai, he takes it, and he takes it to the side, and he takes cow dung, and he washes it with cow dung, hand to hand pure. And then he cooks a nice dry potato sabji, aloo jeera, very nice, after 5 or 6 hours on the road. So we had to come back to that village, and my bike was a mess, motorcycle was a mess. And they're very, kids says, you can stay. I said, where can we stay? There's a little, you can't imagine how small this town is. It doesn't appear on any map, Dudu. But he said, no, there is one building. It is empty. No one uses. Some Rotary Club, they built it many years ago. So an abandoned building by the Rotary Club, by the grace of the Rotary Club, we were able to lie down that evening. But Rajasthan desert is not very comfortable. In the middle of the summer, hottest time of the year, it is almost like a hellish planet. There is no relief. Everything is hot. Everything you touch the stone, it is hot. If you touch the metal, it is hot. So if you lie down, what can you do? It is hot. So we lie down on the stone floor, and then we tried to lie down. They had no charpoy. They only had metal cot. The metal was like lying on a stove. So we got off the metal, went back onto the ground. It was a little better. So these things you do for Krishna's service. If he gives you this type of austerity, you don't care. We didn't care. It was an adventure. Everything is an adventure in Krishna's service. You don't take it as some chore, some misery. Oh, I'm suffering so much. It's so hard. Is this? Prabhupada said, get out of the kitchen if you can't take the heat. Get out of the kitchen. A very simple way to put it. If you're not up to the task, so take another birth. See you next life or a million lives. This is for your benefit. Prabhupada has done all this for your benefit. He was traveling all over the world, hardly staying any place for a few days. It wasn't for him that we're building beautiful ashram, beautiful temples. This is the only thing we built for him, is the samadhi and his rooms in various places. This is the only thing. Yes, sir. Why hasn't he come to that level? He has already attained that level. But that, it remains concealed until the spiritual master sees. And the question again, Prabhu is asking, it appears to be a very technical process. And you are referencing this idea of Siddhadehi, that you know we have to associate with the eternal associates of the Lord, and And this way we become trained up out to, but yes, that is all there. But the spiritual master is the one who is guiding us in every respect. And, you know, at times Prabhupada would sometimes even chide the devotees. And he had this one exchange in one of the recollections. I can't remember if it was Shruti Kirti or Mukunda Maharaj. And the devotee was saying like this, Prabhupada, I'm not qualified. I don't think I'll ever be qualified. And Prabhupada said, you simply hold on to my dhoti. So what does that mean? If I'm holding on to Prabhupada's dhoti, means I'm staying in his service. I'm not going outside. I'm not going to this place. I'm staying here in ISKCON. This ISKCON, not some other, you know, phantasmagoria. Someone is saying this, this is not the real ISKCON. This is this. No. Prabhupada said, you hold on to my dhoti. I know a back door into the spiritual world. It's not what you know, it's who you know. So I want to know, who is Srila Prabhupada? I have no capacity. I know, we know these things, we've heard, so many things. What should be done, what level, who's this, who's that, Kanishta, Uttama, Madhya. It's there. But faith is not based on some technical proficiency. Faith is based on this unalloyed, unmotivated, uninterrupted devotion. So anyone can do that. Anyone can do that. And this society is meant specifically for that. Because it's very difficult to place that faith in something else. And someone says, oh, but my faith has already been broken. I've been there, I've done that. I was burnt out, I got this, I got that. There are reasons these things happen to us. Yes, it does happen. And it is not that we are absolved of fault. No, yes. We have made mistakes in the past. We have to acknowledge them. But there is no better place, no better opportunity to go back home, back together, than to remain at the lotus feet of Srila Prabhupada. Srila Prabhupada said, I am ISKCON. Everyone knows that story? Guru Kripa Maharaj, he was expressing exactly this sentiment. Guru Kripa Maharaj, you see on the wall there's a panel. By his hard work and dedication, he provided much of the donations to build this temple and others. So in Prabhupada's room in Mayapur, he was complaining. Prabhupada, I don't like my god brothers. I don't like. Because there's personalities have conflicts. This is the problem. We have baggage in the form of our material mind and attachments. So sometimes these manifest themselves, and we say, oh, I don't like this person. For whatever reason, doesn't matter. Prabhupada also gave that example, you cannot have two swords in the same scabbard. Because there's this rattling. So he would put two people of a similar nature in different locations to open centers. Because together there was always problems. So Guru Kripa was like, I don't like my god brothers. Prabhupada said, and I don't like this ISKCON. I don't like this society. It seems there's some material focus in something or other. So Prabhupada looked at him and said, I am ISKCON. You don't like me? He said, yes, Prabhupada, I like you. He said, I am ISKCON. So it was clear, Prabhupada understood exactly what he was saying. And now we have to understand exactly what Srila Prabhupada is saying. So it is up to us to maintain that sense. Those of us who are a little older, we remember this movement. Sometimes people say in a different way. It's not a different way. We like to think that we were remembering it the way it should be. There was one pointed attention on serving Srila Prabhupada, distributing his books. Books are the basis, purity is the force, utility is the principle, preaching is the essence. What has changed? So if we lose that, yes, then we have lost. Prabhupada said, if you have lost that bhava, he said that here in Vrindavan in 1976, then this whole temple will become a godown. Everyone knows what a godown is? This whole temple will become a godown. What does that mean? Because the deities were not getting fresh flowers. Things were left being unrepaired. He said, and he even went so far as to say, you're thinking this rascal spiritual master has given us such a burden, heavy burden. He was reading our minds. He knows what we're thinking in every circumstance. So we shouldn't want to become displeasing to the spiritual master. And that, if we just remember that, how to serve him, what I should be doing, we should anticipate. That is a servant. He anticipates the needs of the master. He doesn't just wait to be called. But he knows that if the spiritual master wants water, he brings water, not milk. That Prabhupada said. If I want milk, I will ask for milk. If I want water, please bring me water. But certain things we can anticipate. One of them is we should keep ourselves as clean as possible inside and out. That's not a very difficult thing to do. That's the beginning. And that means mentally, physically, spiritually, every aspect. That's Chaita Darpana. Any other questions, comments? It's a little late. Tell him President's giving some look. No, he's looking at the deities. Srila Prabhupada ki, Srimad Bhagavatam ki, Semble devotees ki, jai.